Hello, my name is Lou Anglo. I'm a urologist with Mercy Clinic St. Louis. I am assuming that you or a loved one was recently diagnosed with prostate cancer. We certainly understand the angst of being diagnosed with prostate cancer. Generally, most prostate cancers are very slow growing, and as a result, there are multiple treatment options to choose from. Of course, the treatment options depend upon each patient's individual situation. During the ensuing discussion, I hope to provide an overview of prostate cancer and the various treatment options available. This discussion is not meant to be all-inclusive, rather an overview. Your physician will be able to give you more details as regards your individual diagnosis and treatment options. Over the next several slides, I will attempt to provide you an overview of the grading and staging of prostate cancer. Your own physician can go over the specifics of your grade and stage, as well as if you need any further staging studies. When the pathologist receives the tissue that was obtained from your recent biopsy, it is prepared and stained. The pathologist then reviews this to look for cancer. Once the diagnosis of cancer is made, the pathologist then attempts to grade the cancer. The grading is somewhat subjective and can vary slightly from pathologist to pathologist, but generally is fairly close. The pathologist will assign what is called a Gleason score. The Gleason score is determined by looking at the gland pattern seen microscopically. The Gleason score consists of two numbers that are added together. The pathologist will determine the predominant pattern and then a secondary pattern. For example, Gleason 7, 3 plus 4, is noted to have a predominant Gleason 3 pattern and a secondary Gleason 4 pattern, thus making it a 7. The question arises as to what your score is and what does that mean. Your urologist will be able to tell you what your score is and can provide you a copy of your pathology report. Generally, we will look at the cancer as being well differentiated or slower growing, moderately differentiated, and poorly differentiated as noted on the slide. The higher the Gleason score, the potentially more aggressive the cancer can be, with more likelihood that it will grow quicker and spread earlier. There are various imaging studies that may or may not be utilized to further stage your cancer. In times past, we always obtained CT scans and bone scans on everyone that was diagnosed with prostate cancer. We found that generally these were not very helpful except in very high-grade cancers. Unfortunately, all of these staging studies are not very good at telling us what is happening on a microscopic level. In the large majority of patients, if the cancer has spread, it is generally on a microscopic level and not a macroscopic or gross level. Having said that, a decision whether to perform staging studies will be a discussion that you and your physician will have depending upon your individual situation. Most people, when diagnosed with prostate cancer, will want to know what the stage of their cancer is. Staging is divided between clinical and pathologic. Clinical staging is determined by such things as a PSA level, physical exam, and staging studies. Pathologic staging is dependent upon the actual pathology report, whether it be from a biopsy or from surgical removal. Your urologist will go through your individual findings and provide to you your prostate cancer stage. Briefly, clinical stage T1C cancer means that it was found because of an elevated PSA blood test. Most prostate cancers that are detected nowadays are found because of an elevated or changing PSA. Pathologic stage T1 prostate cancer is diagnosed when cancer is found during a transurethral resection of the prostate, or TURP, which is performed for urination problems. Clinical stage T2 is determined by physical examination, and a prostate nodule or nodules are found either on one side or both sides. Pathologic stage T2 disease is determined either by the biopsy or surgical removal and depends upon whether cancer is found on one or both sides. Clinical stage T3 is determined either by physical examination or staging studies showing that the cancer has spread outside the prostate locally. Pathologic stage T3 disease is determined either by biopsy or surgical removal, which reveals extraprostatic extension. Clinical stage T4 disease is determined by staging studies. Pathologic stage T4 is determined either by biopsy of the lesions noted on staging studies or by lymph node sampling. Again, your urologist will go through your particular cancer diagnosis and provide you a stage. For the remainder of the program, I will be discussing the anatomy around the prostate and also discuss the various treatment options available for the treatment of prostate cancer. In discussing the various treatment options for prostate cancer, I think it is important that one have a general idea of the anatomy in the area around the prostate. As you review these two diagrams, I hope to point out various aspects of the anatomy. For lack of a better analogy, think of the bladder as being similar to a water balloon. The stem of the balloon is the urethra. This is a tube which passes from the bladder, through the prostate, and out through the penis. The prostate sits at the base of the bladder as denoted by the arrow. On the outside of your body, the prostate is generally located between the rectum and the scrotum as denoted by the orange arrow. The tubes that drain the kidneys into the bladder are called the ureters. They open into the bladder and are called the ureteral orifices. Now refer to the diagram on the left. Part of the muscles for urinary control are located at the tip of the prostate as denoted by the arrow and are called the external sphincter. The other muscles for urinary control run along the urethra and into the prostate. They are called the internal sphincter. This complex of muscles is responsible for urinary control. The dash marks on the left and right sides noted on the left-sided diagram show the paths of the nerve bundles. As you can notice, these run right alongside the prostate. As a result, this is one of the reasons that erectile dysfunction can occur with any treatment for prostate cancer. On the diagram on the right, you will see side views which show you the bladder, the urethra, the prostate, seminal vesicles and vas deferens, and the rectum. As a result, any treatment for prostate cancer can have an effect on some of the surrounding structures, such as the bladder, the ureters, the urethra, the nerves and blood vessels for erections, the sphincter mechanism for urinary and rectal control, and the rectum itself, to list a few. Again, your urologist can go over the fine details of the anatomy further if needed. On this slide, I have listed all the various prostate cancer treatment options that you may come across when researching about your prostate cancer. The last two treatment options of chemotherapy and gene or vaccine therapy typically are utilized for advanced stages of prostate cancer rather than early stage prostate cancer. I just mentioned these as you may come across these as you research things on your own. In the ensuing slides, we will discuss the other options listed. Again, this is an overview and hopefully informative, but not meant to be all-inclusive. Your treatment options will be determined by various factors such as the stage of your disease as well as your age and underlying health. Ultimately, it really comes down to your personal preference and what you are willing to go through and not go through. Of course, your urologist and primary care physician can also aid in helping you make a decision as well. The first treatment option to be discussed is active surveillance, also known as watchful waiting or observation. This is not an active treatment. It consists of watching your cancer and looking for any signs of progression using a combination of blood tests, x-rays, physical examination, etc. Treatment is only undertaken when progression is noted or if problems arise from cancer growth or spread. Typically, we check a PSA every 3 to 6 months along with prostate exams. We then perform a repeat prostate ultrasound and biopsy 6 to 12 months after the initial diagnosis and then yearly. This is to see if we detect more cancer or to see if the Gleason score changes. Active surveillance is becoming more and more used as we learn the natural history of prostate cancer. The good news is to most patients that prostate cancer is generally a slow-growing cancer and may never impact your life. This option is usually utilized in situations such as older age, a patient with multiple medical conditions that may ultimately impact their life, low volume and early disease, patient choice, etc. The advantage of active surveillance is that there is no active treatment and as a result no side effects occur unless the cancer progresses. The disadvantages of this approach are the following. There is no test available that will reliably notify us definitively that the cancer is progressing. As a result, the cancer could spread outside of the prostate gland without detection and thus making a potentially curable cancer incurable. As stated previously, cancer typically spreads on a microscopic level first, thus making it difficult with our current technology to notify us of the potential for impending spread. Another option is hormone deprivation therapy. The whole idea of this therapy is to block or take away testosterone. Testosterone is the male hormone that can influence the prostate gland and prostate cancer growth. The large majority of testosterone is made by the testicles, with a smaller amount being made by the adrenal glands. The adrenal glands are two glands that sit above the kidneys. Hormone deprivation is attained either by removal of the testicles, chemical castration using injections, or a combination of injections, testicle removal, and oral medications. Sometimes we do hormone deprivation in combination with surgery and/or radiation, as some studies have shown that this may have an additive effect in high-risk prostate cancers. We also use hormone deprivation to shrink the prostate at times so that we can perform a radiation seed implant or other procedures. The reason being is that a patient with a very large prostate can have difficulty in treating the gland, and one can also have more postoperative problems in terms of urinary retention, urinary frequency, burning with urination, etc. Unfortunately, this therapy is not a curative therapy. Typically, this is used for advanced disease that has spread outside of the prostate gland. It also has multiple short-term and potential long-term side effects. The short-term effects are hot flashes, decreased sex drive, erectile dysfunction, tiredness, irritability, mood swings, etc. It can be very similar to when women undergo menopause. The long-term side effects can be increased body weight, increased body mass index secondary to weight gain, increased body fat deposition, insulin resistance, predisposing the patient to diabetes or worsened diabetes control, as well as potential for cardiovascular and mentation issues. Because of the potential short-term and long-term side effects of this therapy, we are now using this in a much more judicious manner. Cryosurgical ablation of the prostate is essentially freezing of the prostate gland. It is a surgery in which needles are placed into the prostate through the skin into the area between the scrotum and rectum. The needles are placed using ultrasound and template guidance. Argon gas is then delivered into the needles, which causes a freezing of the tissue. Typically, the procedure entails a freezing, thawing, and another freezing cycle. The procedure takes approximately 2 to 3 hours, depending upon the size of the gland, as well as how many cycles are performed. The potential advantages of cryosurgical ablation are that it is usually an outpatient or overnight procedure. The operation time again is about 2 to 3 hours. Incontinence or leakage of urine is very rare. There is minimal blood loss. It is also one of the least invasive procedures and allows the possibility for quicker recovery and return to normal activity. The potential disadvantages for cryosurgical ablation are the following. If one performs cryosurgical ablation first, it can make radical prostatectomy much more difficult because of the scarring effect and reaction from the freezing process. It is not to say that it cannot be done, but it is much more technically demanding with potential for more damage to surrounding structures. The freezing process can itself also injure surrounding structures such as the rectum, the bladder, the ureters, the nerves for erections, and the ureter orifice. This may or may not require early or late intervention or reconstruction. The good news is that this has improved significantly over the years, and this has become less likely. One can also develop side effects to the rectum, such as rectal pain, hemorrhoid irritation, etc. One can also develop increased urinary symptoms, such as increased frequency of urination, burning with urination, pain with urination. If one does have freezing damage to the rectum, bladder, or urethra, they can develop a fistula, which is an abnormal connection between the rectum and the bladder and or urethra. This potentially could require other interventional procedures such as closure of the fistula or temporary diverting colostomy. One can also develop problems with local recurrence causing urinary obstruction of the bladder, or if local recurrence does occur, it can invade into the bladder and obstruct the kidneys and cause kidney failure. The good news is that most prostate cancers are slow growing and less likely to do this and should respond readily to therapy. The freezing technique has been noted to be very good at destroying tissue. The problem that I personally see with this is that after a treatment, a patient then has devascularized necrotic tissue. It appears very similar to mashed potatoes. Because of this, I have found that patients tend to have more issues with chronic pain and recurrent infections. The other issue, especially for younger patients or patients with good sexual function, is that there is a high rate of immediate erectile dysfunction without a good chance for long-term recovery, as the freezing process is very damaging to the neurovascular bundles responsible for good erectile function. High intensity focused ultrasound, or HIFU for short, is a surgical procedure in which a transrectal ultrasound probe is inserted into the rectum. The sound waves are then intensified and localized to the prostate, which then heats the prostate to high temperatures, which destroys the prostatic tissue. Typically, people will have some problems with urination after the procedure, probably because of reaction to the heating process with swelling, which can obstruct the outflow of urine. A lot of times, a catheter is inserted into the bladder from the belly, called a suprapubic catheter. This is typically left in place for 1 to 2 weeks until the patient is voiding normally. The potential advantages of HIFU are that it is typically an outpatient surgical procedure with a much shorter operative time of approximately 2 to 3 hours. Incontinence is very rare and there is very minimal blood loss. There also appears to be less erectile dysfunction associated with this as opposed to the freezing process. Because it is less invasive, patients tend to recuperate quickly and get back to more normal activities sooner. Potential disadvantages of HIFU are the following. If one performs HIFU therapy first, it can make performing a salvage radical prostatectomy much more difficult because of the scarring effect and reaction from the heating process. Again, it can be done, but may be more technically demanding with the potential for more damage to surrounding structures. Just as in cryoablation of the prostate, one can develop side effects and complications with the rectum, bladder, and other surrounding structures. The other problem currently is that the machines are not FDA approved at this point for the treatment of prostate cancer, although there are several centers in the United States that are testing the machines for safety and efficacy. Currently, a patient must travel out of the country to have this procedure performed, such as in Canada, Mexico, and several Caribbean nations. At this time, insurance does not cover this procedure. Another option is targeted or focal therapy utilizing cryosurgical ablation or HIFU. This is a surgical procedure using a freezing or heating process, focusing the ablative energy just to the area where the cancer has been found. The potential advantages are that it is even less invasive and potentially less damaging to surrounding tissues. One can liken this to a breast lumpectomy where only the cancerous tumor is removed, preserving the remaining gland. The potential disadvantages of treating cancer this way would be the fact that the entire gland is not being treated. As a result, undetected cancers may not be treated, thus leaving cancer cells behind with the potential for continuing to grow and spread. The treatment area is dependent upon biopsy data, which notoriously has a large sampling error associated with it. As stated previously, we do not have very good imaging studies to stage prostate cancer, nor to pinpoint tumors within the prostate gland. Currently, there are no long-standing studies supporting this approach, although short-term studies are promising. Typically, this approach is suggested for very low-volume disease, which may in true fact be good candidates for active surveillance. Another option is external beam radiation. What this implies is that an external beam of radiation utilizing either photons or protons are directed from various angles to the prostate. The good news is that radiation has improved dramatically over the years in terms of the ability to target the prostate, thus allowing us to increase the dose of radiation, which seems to improve overall outcomes as well as minimizing some of the potential side effects. The radiation does have to pass through the body and as a result can affect surrounding structures such as the bladder, rectum, pelvis, nerves for erections, sphincter muscles, as well as some of the surrounding structures described previously. For the patient, all they have to do is lie on the table and the radiation is directed into the prostate from various angles. Generally, the treatments take anywhere from 25 to 40 minutes and are delivered daily. Typically, it takes approximately 7 to 8 weeks to complete a treatment cycle. The potential advantages of external beam radiation are that it is simple in that the patient just has to lie on the table and the radiation is directed into the prostate. There is no surgery involved, there is no anesthesia, and risks from undergoing anesthesia. There really is no blood loss, and incontinence either with the bladder or rectum is extremely rare. Another advantage is that the treatment is given in and around the prostate and could theoretically destroy any cancer cells that may have escaped. Other than active surveillance, this is probably the least invasive technique. The potential disadvantages of external beam radiation are the following. Radiation treatments fail because the cancer is already spread outside the gland, the radiation doesn't completely destroy all the cancerous cells, or it doesn't destroy all glands, and benign cells then transform into cancer. If one proceeds with any type of radiation first, most urologists do not perform salvage prostatectomy procedures because the complications go up significantly, especially in terms of incontinence, impotence, and rectal injuries, which would require diverting colostomies. This is because the radiation is not only good at treating cancer, but does affect the surrounding tissue and essentially causes a scarring effect. As a result, the usual planes of dissection are not there, and a lot more dissection, cutting, etc. is employed to free the prostate. Salvage procedures that may be performed in the face of radiation failures are radical prostatectomy, cryosurgical ablation, high-intensity focused ultrasound, etc. There are some centers around the United States that do salvage prostatectomies, so the door is not completely closed. Radiation is time-consuming. It takes 5 days a week for 7 to 8 weeks. The treatments generally last 25 to 40 minutes, so it is definitely a daily time commitment. Most patients do develop short-term side effects from the radiation. Radiation is good at destroying cancerous tissue, but will also affect the surrounding tissues. A lot of men will develop issues with the bladder and rectum where they get frequency and urgency of urination, burning with urination, occasionally developing difficulty with urination, etc. They can also get some hemorrhoid irritation, diarrhea, or bleeding from the rectum. The good news is that this generally occurs later in the treatments and usually subsides within 4 to 6 weeks of completing radiation. However, there is always a small chance that a patient has long-term side effects and problems as a result of radiation damage to the surrounding tissues. If the radiation does not destroy all the cancer or scars the entire gland and benign glands convert to cancer, then the cancer can grow back locally and cause obstruction of the bladder, resulting in urination problems. It can also grow locally into the bladder and block the kidney tubes, thus blocking the kidneys and causing kidney failure. It can also grow into the rectum and cause issues there as well. Again, this is not common, but is less likely if the prostate is removed. We used to tell patients that if they didn't want problems with impotence, go with radiation. Over time, we have found that radiation patients also develop problems. It tends to be less dramatic on the front end as with surgery, but does occur with time. Anywhere from 30 to 70% of men will develop problems with erectile dysfunction over a 3 to 5 year period. It is probably from the scarring effect of the radiation, which affects the blood vessels and nerves. One can also develop scar tissue in the urethra just as one can with surgery. The urine tube narrows and can cause difficulty with urination, thus requiring intervention. There is also a slight, less than 1% chance of developing a bladder or rectal malignancy as a result of the radiation passing through these tissues. A prostate seed implant is a surgical procedure. The patient is placed under anesthesia. Using ultrasound and x-ray guidance, multiple seeds are placed into the prostate. This is done by passing needles through the skin in the area between the rectum and scrotum. The number of seeds is determined by the size of the prostate as well as the amount and location of the cancer. The number of seeds can vary anywhere from 80 to 150 or so. These are permanent and will not be removed. The radiation will slowly decay and go away over time. The length of time depends on whether palladium or iodine is used. To be a good candidate for a seed implant, the prostate should measure less than 50 milliliters and the patient should not have a lot of pre-existent urinary symptoms such as slow stream, difficulty starting, going frequently, getting up at night, etc. Patients with these symptoms tend to have more problems after the procedure and for a longer period of time. The potential advantages of a seed implant are the following. This is generally performed as an outpatient with the large majority of men going home the same day of the procedure. You may or may not have to go home with a catheter. The operative time is much shorter and generally is less than an hour. Also, the radiation is delivered all at once without need for repeated treatments unless one is doing a combination of external radiation and seed implantation. Sometimes we recommend a combination of external beam radiation plus a seed implant boost. This is generally done in people with higher risk prostate cancer, such as men with PSAs greater than 10, Gleason scores 7 or greater, larger volume disease, etc. Rectal and urinary incontinence is extremely rare. Urinary incontinence is a little higher in patients who have had prior prostate surgery for urination problems, but still is rare. The procedure is less invasive and most patients can be back to normal activity in several days to a week or so. The potential disadvantages of a seed implant are basically the same as those discussed with external beam radiation, since it is just another way to get radiation into the prostate. The only caveat is that patients who undergo a seed implant tend to have more urinary side effects, which can last a little longer at times than external beam radiation. The next option to be discussed is radical prostatectomy. This is a surgical approach in which the entire prostate gland, in addition to the seminal vesicles and parts of the vas deferens, are removed intact. One must then reconstruct the urinary tract by connecting the bladder back to the urethra. We will spend a fair amount of time discussing radical prostatectomy, as it is the most invasive approach with potential for more side effects, but also carries the possibility of completely eradicating the tumor if it is truly confined to the prostate gland. In these diagrams, it shows what has happened after the prostate gland along with the seminal vesicles and parts of the vas deferens have been removed. Essentially, there is a gap created between the bladder and the urethral stump. One then must reconstruct the anatomy by sewing the bladder back to the urethral stump. For lack of a better analogy, we have to reconnect the plumbing. A catheter is then placed through the penis into the bladder. A balloon is blown up at the end of the catheter to keep it in place. The catheter is typically left in place from anywhere between 5 and 21 days, depending upon the type of the procedure that is performed, whether it be open, laparoscopic, robotic, etc., as well as the amount of reconstruction that is required. The more reconstruction, the longer the catheter must remain. No matter how one performs the surgery, the procedure itself is ultimately the same. The prostate is removed, and then the urinary tract is reconstructed. The potential advantages of radical prostatectomy over other treatment options is that it provides the opportunity to remove all of the cancer as well as providing local control. After radical prostatectomy, cancer can recur because of two reasons. The cancer has already extended outside the prostate gland, or cancer is cut across at the time of surgery and left behind. The surgeon can also tailor the surgery according to the aggressiveness of the cancer. They can get very close to the prostate, attempting to spare nerve bundles for lower grade cancer, or they can go further away from the prostate for more aggressive cancers to potentially catch any cancer cells that locally escaped outside of the gland. Another advantage of radical prostatectomy is that we do obtain the pathology readout, giving us more objective information, such as where the cancer is, how much cancer is present, a more accurate Gleason score, a more objective determination of whether the cancer is contained or has extended outside the prostate gland. By having this information, we may be able to better direct patients to other treatments that may have an impact on their cancer survival. Also, if one performs radical prostatectomy first, radiation therapy, hormone deprivation therapy, chemotherapy, vaccine therapy, or some combination are still available for any failure. If one performs radiation therapy first, or even freezing or heating, the complication rate with radical prostatectomy increases dramatically, and therefore most urologists do not perform this procedure as a salvage procedure. Having said that, there are several centers around the country that do perform the procedure as a salvage approach, such as MD Anderson, City of Hope in Los Angeles, Memorial Sloan Kettering, Mayo Clinic, Johns Hopkins, to list a few. The potential disadvantages of radical prostatectomy are that it is a major surgery no matter how the surgery is performed, with potential for complications. There is also a risk for recurrence despite obtaining a favorable pathology report. As stated earlier, cancer can spread microscopically, and we are not aware of this. Therefore, one could go through the surgery and the potential risks of surgery and still not cure the cancer. The good news is that we are much better at doing the surgery overall than we ever have been, with a much lower complication rate and lower recurrence rate. We are also catching the cancers at a much earlier stage, making surgery much more successful in terms of curing cancer. On this slide, I've listed some general potential complications in the early postoperative period. The good news is that we are much better at performing the surgery than we ever have been, and the complication rate has decreased dramatically over the years. Again, we are also seeing a much lower recurrence rate. On this slide, I have listed some of the long-term quality of life side effects and complications that can arise after radical prostatectomy. We are going to spend a fair amount of time discussing these in the following slides. The reality of treating prostate cancer by any modality is that it can and does have potential side effects. Probably the biggest drawback to the treatment of prostate cancer, and especially via radical prostatectomy, is the potential for short-term and long-term erectile dysfunction, also known as impotence. With surgery, most men will not be able to have erections right away after surgery, but hopefully, with time, they will gradually regain the ability to have erections. Having said that, erectile dysfunction is probably the biggest wild card as regards surgery besides the cancer itself. No one can give guarantees about the success of nerve sparing, as various factors can play a role in the outcomes of this approach, such as individual patient anatomy, the amount of inflammation or scarring surrounding the prostate, the anatomy of the neurovascular bundles, etc. Pre-existing conditions such as diabetes, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, obesity, and pre-existing erectile dysfunction can also play roles in outcomes. Unfortunately, the nerves for erections are not large nerves, nor are they single nerves with one on the right and one on the left. As you can see on the diagram on the slide, it is actually a bundle of nerves on the left and right sides. The prostate sits on top of the rectum, and in between the prostate and rectum and alongside the prostate sit the neurovascular bundles. It is similar to a hammock in which the prostate lies in. The nerves themselves are very fine and delicate and much smaller than a piece of hair, therefore making them difficult to visualize and or feel. I like to say they're like cobwebs. The more cobwebs that we can preserve in the process of doing the surgery, the greater chance that one may have the ability to regain erections. Having said that, just like walking through a door with cobwebs, inevitably some will be torn and damaged. If nerves are torn, cauterized, cut, they will not regenerate. Unfortunately, nerves are very sensitive and are bruised very readily in the process of doing this procedure as well, and can take many months or years to heal themselves, if at all. The reality is that the quality of erections typically is not as good as one had prior to surgery, but the hope is that erectile function will return with time. Again, this is the wild card. We can and will be as aggressive as the patient wishes to be in what we call post-prostatectomy penile rehabilitation, which includes utilizing various medications, devices, injections, so that it may help in the return of function, as well as allowing the patient and their partner to resume sexual function much sooner. The other big wild card in terms of radical prostatectomy is postoperative urinary incontinence, or leakage of urine. No matter how the surgery is performed, whether it is open, laparoscopic, or robotic, one will experience varying degrees of incontinence initially. I tell people that they will generally leak a large amount of urine initially after the catheter comes out, and then over the next 2 to 4 months, the patient will gradually regain the ability to control their urine. Of course, there is always a risk of persistent complete incontinence. The good news is that this occurs very rarely and occurs in less than 3% of people undergoing radical prostatectomy. So to discuss the anatomy somewhat further, I will refer to the diagram on the slide. Prior to surgery, the male has a prostate which provides outlet resistance to the outflow of urine and as a result helps in the continence mechanism. Men also have a longer urethra and what we call the internal sphincter, which also provides a continence mechanism. Once the prostate is removed, the patient is much more dependent upon his pelvic floor muscles, which we call the external sphincter, and a shortened urethra or an internal sphincter. The anatomy is much more like a woman's anatomy in that the continence mechanism is much more dependent on the shorter urethra and the external sphincter. Women in general have much more issues with stress incontinence as they age, have babies, etc. because of this anatomy. Stress incontinence means leaking with coughing, sneezing, lifting, etc., in which any increase in abdominal pressure can overcome the sphincter mechanisms and result in leakage of urine. Unlike a woman's anatomy, because they have the birth canal, men have much more fixed points for their pelvic muscles, allowing much better and efficient function for urinary control. The good news is that most men, given time, will regain urinary control. The real question is, how long will it take to get from point A to point B? Again, this generally occurs over a 2 to 4 month time frame. Some men regain control earlier than others. Lifelong, men may always have some degree of intermittent incontinence after radical prostatectomy, such as with a sudden sneeze, twisting, passing gas, having bowel movements, etc. It's generally not large amounts, but rather drops. Various things that play a role in urinary incontinence are patient anatomy, where sometimes the urethra is really short in relation to the prostate, a large prostate requiring removal of more urethra, excising the cancer itself, pre-existent urinary symptoms, morbid obesity, diabetes, underlying neurologic dysfunction, etc. The patient can help themselves in terms of trying to regain urinary control. A series of pelvic exercises can be performed before and after the operation to help strengthen the pelvic muscles and therefore improve urinary control. The main exercise is called Kegel exercises, and your physician should instruct you on how to perform these exercises. If you are considering surgery at all, you should start these now. Some of the other potential long-term side effects from surgery that one may encounter are the following. One can develop scar tissue either at the area where the bladder and urethra are sewn back together or anywhere along the urethra. What happens is that the tube closes down, obstructing the outflow of urine. It can reach a critical point in which the patient cannot then void and is in retention. If this occurs, the patient will require intervention to open the channel. Luckily, this does not occur commonly and occurs in less than 5% of people undergoing radical prostatectomy. Men will also notice that their penis is shorter after radical prostatectomy, no matter by what approach is used. The thought process behind this is twofold. First, the patient does not get erections because of bruising of the nerves and the tying off of blood vessels in the process of doing the surgery. As a result, the blood vessels that fill within the penis for erection will shrink down. The other reason is that the prostate is removed and the bladder and urethra are sewn back together. In the process of doing this, the urethra and penis can be pulled in to a certain degree. We're not talking a large amount of length loss, but it can be noticeable. It really varies from man to man. Large men with a more prominent fat pad above the penis tend to notice this more than others. A lot of men and women as they age will develop urinary symptoms of frequency, getting up more at night, urgency, and occasional urge incontinence. Unfortunately, we cannot promise that surgical removal of the prostate will remove any of these symptoms and potentially could worsen them. The reason for this is that the urination and voiding process is not just related to the prostate. It is a combination of things such as the bladder itself, the pelvic muscles, the nervous system affecting the bladder and urethra, hormones, things you eat or drink, etc. Most men, once they regain their urinary control, will notice a much improved flow of stream, but again, this cannot be promised. There are multiple other things that can occur after radical prostatectomy, but these are the most common. The list is not meant to be all-inclusive, rather to be used as points for discussion. Through better surgical technique, we continue to minimize some of the potential side effects. Radical prostatectomy continues to be an excellent choice in the treatment of prostate cancer, especially for the correct candidates. As you do your research regarding prostate cancer, you will find that there are multiple approaches for performing a radical prostatectomy. It is my belief that no approach is definitively superior to the other. Rather, it comes down to the experience of your surgeon and the technique that they are using and your own personal preference. All approaches have pros and cons. Also, one way may be better than another depending upon the clinical situation. Generally, there are four basic surgical approaches. One approach is the standard open retropubic approach, where an incision is made into the abdomen and the prostate is approached from that aspect. In the perineal approach, the incision is made between the scrotum and rectum and the prostate is approached from that aspect. Laparoscopy is an approach where multiple small tubes are passed into the abdomen and then a camera and longer instruments are used to perform the procedure. Laparoscopy is performed two ways. One way is a straight laparoscopic approach where the surgeon is at the bedside using longer instruments to do all the sewing, cutting, etc. The other is a robotic approach in which laparoscopic ports are placed into the abdomen, robotic arms are then attached to the ports, Instruments are then placed into position, and the surgeon then manipulates the instruments by using a surgical console. Your urologist can go into more details regarding the pros and cons of each approach. Later in this slideshow, I will attempt to go over some of the pros and cons of an open versus robotic / laparoscopic approach. As previously discussed, there are several different ways to perform a radical prostatectomy. Each physician or institution may have their preferred approach. My personal and professional belief is that no one approach is superior to the other. I believe that all approaches are very good surgical procedures in experienced hands. I think the key determining factor is the experience of your surgeon and their comfort with their technique. Ultimately, it really comes down to the patient and surgeon preference. There certainly are pros and cons of each approach and certain indications for doing one procedure over another. A lot of these can be discussed as it relates to a patient's personal history and situation. I see a lot of patients for second opinions as regards robotic radical prostatectomy. This is my own personal preferred approach, if possible, to perform a radical prostatectomy. In true fact, greater than 70% of radical prostatectomy cases are performed utilizing the Da Vinci surgical system at this time. Over the ensuing slides, I will try to demonstrate why I personally like this approach, as well as trying to discuss some of the pros and cons of each approach. Again, this is not meant to be all-inclusive, but rather a means for information. More details can be discussed with your physician. Over the years, radical prostatectomy has improved dramatically in terms of outcomes and techniques. First of all, I want to explain what the Da Vinci surgical system is. It is a state-of-the-art robotic platform. The patient is placed on a surgical table and laparoscopic ports are placed in position by your surgeon. For a radical prostatectomy, most surgeons will utilize 5 or 6 ports. 4 of the ports are for the robotic arms and instruments, and 1 to 2 are for the bedside assistant. The robotic arms are then attached to these ports and instruments are placed into position to perform the surgery. The instruments are controlled by the surgeon. The robot does not do anything on its own. A surgical assistant is at your bedside at all times, as well as your anesthesiologist or nurse anesthetist. The surgical assistant will assist with things such as exchanging the instruments, passing sutures, placing clips, suctioning, and whatever is needed to assist the surgeon in doing the procedure. The surgeon will perform the large majority of the surgery sitting at a surgical console manipulating instruments to perform the surgery. The surgeon is readily available if anything is needed at bedside, which is extremely rare. A lot of people will discuss the pros and cons of a robotic approach. On a personal matter, I like utilizing the robotic approach for the following reasons. First of all, I believe that I have a lot of individual control during the procedure and am less dependent upon my assistants. I am able to move the camera on my own and to the area that I wish to focus on. The other 3 working arms allow me a lot more independence in terms of doing the procedure. The robot does not get tired, nor does it get bored. It also does exactly what I want it to do. I also find that I can do complex maneuvers much easier with the robot than I can at times with straight laparoscopy or even open with handheld instruments. Secondly, I also believe that I can visualize things a lot better given the fact that I have a high-definition, 3-dimensional camera with 10 times magnification. Typically, there is much less bleeding as opposed to other approaches, which aids in the process of visualization. I am also able to change the lens angle so that I can visualize things easier from different angles. I am also able to bring the camera down closer to the working area for better visualization. I personally believe that I see better than an open surgeon does at various aspects of the procedure. This may or may not be advantageous in the overall outcomes, but I truly find it to be helpful. Thirdly, because we have a computer between the surgeon and the patient, it allows us to have complex instrumentation. We are able to have articulating instruments which can simulate hand movements right at the point of care. It can make difficult and complex aspects of the procedure easier and less physically taxing on the surgeon. Again, it is only a tool and it comes down to the experience of your surgeon and the individual anatomy of the patient, as well as the cancer itself. From a surgical standpoint, it is oftentimes more ergonomic for the surgeon to perform a robotic approach than either an open or straight laparoscopic approach. A lot is said about not being able to feel the tissue one is working with, or in the case of straight laparoscopic, having the ability to feel torque or resistance. In my personal and professional experience, the lack of touch is more than compensated by improved visualization, instrumentation, and ultimately by surgeon experience. With experience, one can develop the ability to assess tissue changes both visually as well as with some feedback from the instruments, along with how the instruments are interacting with the tissues. Also, studies have shown that in experienced hands, the outcomes between techniques should be equivalent dependent upon patient anatomy, the cancer, etc. Again, the robot does not do any work on its own. All instruments are manipulated at the time of surgery by the surgeon themselves, unless instruments are being exchanged for various aspects of the procedure by the surgeons and surgeon's assistants. The instruments mimic hand movements intuitively. For example, when I open my fingers on the surgical handpieces, the jaws of the instrument will open. If I move my hands up, down, right, left, the entire instrument will move accordingly. In this slide, you can see some surgical video of the robot in action. My intention is not to try to give you the wow factor. Rather, I just want you to see the instruments in action and to point out that anything that is done open or straight laparoscopically can be done robotically, such as cauterizing with electricity, cutting with scissors, throwing sutures to sew things back together, or tying down stitches just like I would with my hands. In the upper right-hand corner video, you can see a catheter coming out through a urethral stump. In the video, they are actually sewing the urethral stump back to the bladder as described earlier as part of the reconstruction. At times, I find that the robotic approach allows me to do some more complex maneuvers easier than an open procedure. Currently, greater than 70% of radical prostatectomy cases are done utilizing the robot, with 20 to 30% being done open and less than 1% straight laparoscopically. Some of this is certainly secondary to marketing, but I firmly believe that the robotic approach is a very good way to perform a radical prostatectomy. The potential advantages of a da Vinci or even laparoscopic radical prostatectomy are the following. For the most part, there is a lot less blood loss with less chance for blood transfusions and risk with blood transfusions. In my personal experience of having performed, taught, or assisted in over 1,000 da Vinci prostatectomy cases, I've had only one patient require a transfusion. Overall, the technique of radical prostatectomy has continued to improve and is becoming less and less likely that a blood transfusion will be required. Having said that, there typically is much less blood loss associated with a laparoscopic approach as opposed to an open approach. There also tends to be less pain as compared to an open procedure, although this can be very patient-specific as different patients have different pain tolerances. However, in general, laparoscopy does tend to have less postoperative pain, requiring less postoperative pain medications. A lot of people will say that there is a less risk of infection because of smaller incisions and less scarring as a result as well. But in reality, we really do not have a lot of infections with open radical prostatectomy as well. Ultimately, scars are scars, whether they are short or long. The hope is that because there is less blood loss, less pain, and getting off pain medications sooner, etc., patients will hopefully heal quicker and return to more normal activity quicker. Of course, this can be very patient-specific. Also, after about 3 to 4 weeks, open and robotic prostatectomy patients are generally released to start resuming normal exercise activity. Specifics of the do's and don'ts after surgery will be discussed in greater detail by your urologist. I do believe again that I do see better because of my 10 times magnification, 3D high definition cameras, and a lot less bleeding. Again, none of these benefits can be guaranteed as surgery can be both patient and procedure specific. Some of the potential disadvantages that are discussed with a da Vinci or laparoscopic approach are the following. Initially, it used to take much longer to perform a robotic or laparoscopic approach compared to an open. Now we can perform a robotic approach in a similar amount of time. Typically, radical prostatectomy can take 2 to 3.5 hours depending upon various factors. We must also tell all patients that undergo any laparoscopic procedure that we may have to convert to an open procedure for various reasons, such as injury to other structures, not progressing with the planned procedure, or failure of the instrumentation. Fortunately, it is very rare that we have to convert to an open operation even in the face of injuring other structures, as a lot of times it can be repaired robotically or laparoscopically. Because we are entering the abdominal cavity, there is an increased risk of injuring small intestine, major blood vessels, etc. Whereas in an open approach, we do not have to enter what is called the peritoneal cavity. Having said that, it is very rare that we have internal injuries, but I cannot argue the point that if we did this open, there potentially could be none. There are potential side effects from laparoscopy itself, such as adhesion formation, which is an internal scarring that in the future could predispose the patient to bowel obstructions or other problems. But this can also happen with open procedures as well. Having said that, we have done a lot of laparoscopy over the years, and it continues to be one of the first choices of surgical approaches for many diseases. adhesions can form even with open operations. Because the incisions are smaller to insert the ports, the tissues may not heal as well, and there may be an increased incidence of hernia formation that may require surgical repair. One can also have side effects from the carbon dioxide gas that is used to inflate the abdomen, which provides us a working area. The gas also provides a negative pressure against blood vessels, which also helps in decreasing bleeding. The main side effect from carbon dioxide with laparoscopy is diaphragm irritation that can cause shoulder pain, especially to the right side. Very rarely, a carbon dioxide bubble can get into the bloodstream and go to the heart, called a CO2 embolism. This can cause heart arrhythmias or sudden death. Personally, I have never encountered this problem, although it is reported. Especially with a robotic approach, we do have to place the patient with their head down, and this can predispose to increased eye pressure that may cause corneal abrasions or temporary eye pain. This is typically transient and goes away within 24 to 48 hours. There is a very minimal risk of blindness associated with this increased eye pressure. Personally, I have never encountered blindness. One big thing that open surgeons and even straight laparoscopic surgeons will comment on is the lack of tactile sensation using the robotic approach. My personal belief is that there is no disadvantage to not feeling the tissues either with my hand or with some sort of resistance feedback with handheld laparoscopic instruments. I personally feel that this is a non-issue for several reasons. Although I do not actually feel the tissues, I do get some minimal resistant feedback with the instrumentation. I do also believe that I see better than an open surgeon can because of my high definition three-dimensional cameras and the fact that there is a lot less bleeding. I think that the improved visualization allows me to see extremely well, and it is a strong positive when dissecting around the prostate. Finally, I can also say that my own as well as other large series of robotic prostatectomy have shown to be comparable in terms of outcomes. In summary, the robotic approach is definitely not the next best thing since sliced bread. I look at it as a tool to help me perform the procedure. I will not, nor can any surgeon, no matter how they approach the prostate, guarantee better outcomes for cancer cure, nerve sparing, incontinence, etc. Various variables can affect the outcomes no matter how the procedure is performed, such as the age of the patient, general patient anatomy, prostate size, pre-existing erectile dysfunction, the cancer itself, and even pre-existent medical conditions such as heart disease, diabetes, obesity can affect outcomes. Ultimately, I firmly believe that in experienced hands, whether it be an open, laparoscopic, or robotic approach, one should get similar results as we are all attempting to do the same procedure just by different techniques. I also believe that radical prostatectomy will continue to be a good option in the treatment of prostate cancer. In conclusion, this presentation is for informational purposes and is not meant to take the place of a discussion with your physician. The physician-patient relationship is paramount. Your physician will be able to go through the fine points of radical prostatectomy and answer any further questions you may have. Thank you. The next steps, if you haven't already done these, are to make an appointment with your doctor to discuss your cancer and the treatment options available. I encourage you to write down any questions you may have in preparation for your discussion. Also, write them down at any time and get back with your doctor if you have any future questions. I have listed a couple of informational websites that you can look at as well for some more general information. In conclusion, this presentation is for informational purposes only and is not meant to take the place of a discussion with your physician. The physician-patient relationship is paramount. Your physician will be able to go through the fine points of your individual cancer and the treatment options that may be best for you.